guest is the wonderful Nick Van Eed, founder member of Cutting Crew. From working as a hospital orderly in the late 70s, he was discovered at the tender age of 18 by Chas Chandler of The Animals, who sent him out to play support for bands like Slade and David Essex. Nick then formed the Drivers in the early 80s, who were signed to a Canadian record label. That's where he met Kevin McMichael. They joined forces and Cutting Crew was born. Signed to Virgin Records, in 1986, I Just Died in Your Arms was released and went to number one in 19 countries. Yes, number one in 19 countries. It was Virgin Radio's first US hit. The record was recently recognised by BMI for 5 million plays on US radio and is featured in major movie soundtracks and Stranger Things. I've Been in Love Before, the follow-up single, reached number two on the US charts, and Nick has continued writing, recording, producing and touring, including the recent acclaimed album Ransomed, Healed, Restored, Forgiven, recorded with the Prague Philharmonic Orchestra, featuring stunning reworking of many of the hits. Nick has just returned from a cruise tour in the USA and Mexico. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Nick Van Eed. Hello.
Hello. Hi. Beautifully done. Beautifully done, Sharon.
Hello. Well, lovely to see you. We've nearly met a few times and I'm delighted that you agreed to let us interview you because I've had a lot of questions from our fans in Ireland. You're very popular over here. So you happy to answer a few questions for us?
I am. And I also wanted to compliment you on putting my life story in 1.5 minutes. It's great, you know. It's like flashing before my eyes, you know. Some good memories in.
I'm sorry, it's really hard to cover an introduction and make sure that, you know, it's got enough information, but without, you know, trying to make you feel like, whoa.
Especially when you're as old as I am, you know, it's pretty hard.
No, you're looking fabulous. We're all the same age, don't worry. We're all of that age. But I would like to start off with a question from me. Now, yeah. Back in the day, what was it like to be working with bands, supporting bands like Slade, David Essex and Hot Chocolate? What did you learn from working with them? And do you still play the kazoo?
The kazoo, eh? So, yeah, you mentioned that Chas discovered me in a little pub around the back of the hospital where I worked. And I was playing, you know, acoustic guitar, maybe a couple of my own songs, but American Pie and, you know, all the Beatles songs and things. And I didn't have any other hands, you know, and I certainly wasn't going to play harmonica like Bob Dylan. So I used to use the kazoo occasionally. I still have one. I played it jokingly in Mexico recently. So those days were obviously extremely exciting because let's take the Slade story, which was the first of those tours. Playing to a little pub in Sussex to 50 nurses and doctors. And then this man came in and said, "What are you doing next Thursday?" That's my Geordie accent. And I was like, "I don't know, probably sitting here." And he said, "Would you like to come on tour with Slade to Poland?" And I was playing 25,000 amphitheatres. You know, it was 2 weeks later, God honest truth.
Wow.
What I learned was about how you got to muck in, you know, I was the baby on the tour. So they would put electric shocks in the microphones. They sawed the legs off my stool. So I would sit down and fall arse overhead, all kinds of things. So I learned a lot about, you know, ha ha ha, keeping stumm. But from Slade especially, and it's still every second of my life on stage, I learned about having fun, you know, just it's, even if your song is a beautiful love song that may tell, you know, it, the whole show, people have come a long way and parked in some shitty parking lot in the rain, you know, you've got to give off fun. And Slade were the best in the world at that.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant. Now, it's a question from a lot of the fans. How did you come up with the name Cutting Crew? And I'd like to add to that, how do you feel about seeing it being used as a name on so many hair salons?
Exactly. There you go. Just, we're going to be throwing these out into the audience of Forever Young. We've got about 10 more to throw every night.
Yay, super.
The hair salon bit is just hilarious. I mean, I still get emails to Cutting Crew Info asking, you know, how much it would be for a tint and a trim. My office does, of course, not me. But the name was when we made the album. We'd already made it. We hadn't really decided what we were going to be called. The irony of it is that all four of us in the band had played since we were 16 on stage. So we were all seasoned, you know, we knew our chops and our guitars or drums and everything, and we played forever. But Cutting Crew was put together and we hadn't done one gig when this song is hurtling up the charts. So I was reading the newspapers and I saw a review of Queen, and Queen at that time had only been recording and not gigging. So they called themselves a Cutting Crew, like as in cutting records. So it just jumped out at me as a cool name. It kind of backfired a little bit because a year and a half later, when I was in New York, you know, browsing through in the old days when you go browsing through vinyl, I was looking for our album. I couldn't find it anywhere. And I asked the guy, I said, you know, where is it? He said, Cutting Crew, yeah, you're urban dance. Because of the crew thing, crew. Like Dougie Fresh and the Rock. Yeah, exactly. So I had to go over and find my record.
Find your stuff. Right. Well, I'm going to play you a question from Rob.
Hi, Nick. Rob Jackson here from Southern England. Been a massive fan of the band right from the very first album, and have really enjoyed watching you over the years and listening to some really great music. My question: if Cutting Crew were tasked with playing an entire back catalogue album live these days, which album would you choose and why?
Thank you, Rob. It's the thing to do these days, isn't it? All the bands are playing sometimes their signature album, you know, all the way from top to bottom. As much as I adore The Scattering, which is our second album, it's my favourite album. It has to be Broadcast, the first album. It has the big songs on it, but not just because of that, but it was kind of seminal in the way we broke through, of course, but it was, can you imagine, I'd come from The Drivers, which was a three-piece, like, I don't know, XTC meets Squeeze meets Freddie and the Dreamers. It was a crazy 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, so it was wild. Kevin had come from a Canadian kind of King Crimson type prog rock band. So it was where we formed our sound. And I tell you what, Rob, and to you, Sharon, and to any young writers out there, you know when you find the man or the woman that it's with. It's like maybe marriage, you know, you just know. And with Kevin, getting a bit sad here, listen, you spend all your life working very hard writing, and when you find that person that you sit across the room to, and it just went and the songs were easy, you know, they just came out in hours instead of weeks. And so Broadcast will always remind me of those wonderful days. So the answer is Broadcast.
Thank you.
Wiping the tears.
No, well, obviously, you know, that we've all come a long way, and you know, losing people on the way is always makes the journey sometimes, you know, very bittersweet. So Catherine asks, she's a huge fan. Is there going to be a new album soon? You do some fabulous covers and sets, things like the Lido Shuffle, Fall at Your Feet, Follow You, Follow Me. Have you maybe considered doing a covers album?
No. I'm not interested. I think what I suppose if we did a cover set, I'm waffling now. If we did it our way, yes, because we always put a twist on it. So if we play Ironic by Alanis Morissette, you know, I change the lyrics. It's coming from a man. It's a very much rockier version. When we do Fall at Your Feet, it's very tiny. So maybe, but no, not interested at all. I just like throwing them in, like we will be doing in Forever Young, to surprise you. You know, we've got about 6 or 7 up our sleeve, and about halfway through the show, I'll wink at the boys and we'll do one of those. So, no, not about recording it.
But anything else new on the horizon to come out? New material?
Yeah, this is not... Well, maybe it's interesting because it's me and it's an interview about me. It's not just about Cutting Crew. But when I pick up the guitar, you know, and picked up the wrong guitar. You know, I've been doing this since I was 15. That's what I make my money from. That's what I'm apparently quite good at. I have a much better guitarist than the band. But when I was younger, I used to get up at 16 in the middle of the night at 16 years old and write solos. It was the thing, you know. They would be probably shite, but at least I was writing them. And I lost that about maybe 5 years ago. You know, I still want to write, but now it's much more, I will go and write a song, you know, not the excitement. So the answer to your question is I'm writing a book.
Oh.
And it's not a book about me. That would be far too boring. It's about an Irish boy called Vincent from a fantasy county in the south of Ireland who becomes obsessed with random actions. He meets a girl from Japan in Amsterdam who works in a dodgy business, and they go on a spree. That's all I'm going to tell you.
Wow, sounds very exciting. And when's that? When do you think that'll be hitting the shelves?
Well, you know, here's the notes.
Okay, not quite there yet, but it's coming. It's coming.
It's all sketched. Just needs to be typed up, and I'm having my knee replaced on Tuesday.
Oh gosh!
So I will have 2 months sitting on my ARSE. So I will really start writing it then.
That's the time to do it. Yes. The next question is from Damien. When and where was the band's most memorable live performance?
Yeah. No, I think it's an easy answer. This may not have been our best performance, but unforgettable was we played in Taiwan in about 89, and it was the first time they'd ever allowed a Western rock band not play there, but play with the kids standing up. So we asked them to film the moment where they opened the doors. And this is huge. It's like 10, 12,000 people. Because it was a big deal. I think if you and your dogs had played there, there might have been 12,000 people. But you know, it was Cutting Crew. So they filmed it, and these thousands of Chinese people running in, and the first time ever, just at the front of the stage, standing.
Stand up. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was, you know, it beggars belief really now, but that was incredible. So everything that I did on stage, it's all filmed. They're all just so excited. So yeah, Taiwan, 1989.
Fantastic. That's a great story. Fran has asked.
Hi, I'm Fran from Dublin, and your music is currently featuring in A Town Called Malice, and it's been in so many TV shows and films like Ash vs. the Evil Dead, Stranger Things, Hot Tub Time Machine, Lego Batman. What's your criteria for allowing a film or TV show to use your songs?
Sounds like Fran, my publisher. good question, and I am good. You haven't got the list of the ones I've turned down. There's many where I think it's inappropriate, especially on the violence side, because there are a lot of violent movies. And of course, the lyric can mean anything. You know, originally when I wrote it, it was about a night of a lot of fun in with somebody, and with died in your arms, you know, that has many other connotations. So we've had a lot of gangster rap versions of it over the years that I've had to turn down. So there are other films that I've turned down. You have to be careful, you know, you really have to be careful. I can't tell you the latest one that I got approached by, but it's enormous, and it would have paid for half a house. And I swear on my daughter's life, I'm not lying. And I turned it down because it was just naff. And it would just be, we would have been associated with that brand. It's wrong because it's not, you know, I don't care if you think I'm making this up. It's not all about the money. It's about having a bit of class and longevity and keeping the brand going. You know, I know a punk rocker will be going, you're in your f-ing brand. You know, I know it's not exactly the coolest thing to talk about, but yeah, I can tell you one I did turn down was many years ago. An Australian beer company wanted to pay quite a lot of money, and they wanted to use Die in Your Arms. And they sent me the storyboard, you know, the little what it would look like. And it's the guy, this sort of Crocodile Dundee with a hat. And he's sitting there having a drink of this beer they're selling, and the radio plays Died in Their Arms, and he puts the beer down next to the radio, and he pulls it away, and he goes, "Wouldn't want to ruin a good beer, would you?"
That's a good one.
Which I actually find it funny now.
So Brian's asked, were you surprised to get a mention in Dan Walker's book?
Surprised, yes. He's a lovely man. I know Dan. Well, we've done BBC interviews many times over the years. So, we I'm not a friend of his, but it all became of that gorgeous story. If you're not aware, whether it was shown over on BBC or on RTE, whatever, it was about my old music teacher, Paul Harvey, and he has acute dementia, but he still is beautifully good enough for about an hour a day to play gorgeous piano. And I'll make it very quickly. So Dan interviewed me on the day, and it was about this: the son gives the father four notes, random notes, you know, so no, and he'll go, he'll sit at the piano, and he'll write off of his head like a kind of Rachmaninoff piece. Quite beautiful. And I was interviewed by Dan about the old days, you know, how important he was to me. And I'm sure when you speak with many of your other artists, school was either a disaster or was really important. And I was lucky, you know, I went to grammar school for 1 year, and then that was all right. But then it all fell over my age. They became comprehensive schools. So all these young, sexy teachers were arriving, you know, who had just come out of college, and we could call them by their Christian name. And Paul was a little older than that, but he was one of that gang. And, you know, you learned music and you loved it. I'm absolutely convinced I wouldn't be sitting there now if it wasn't for that school that I went to.
Brilliant. So Jane asks,
hi, my question is, how do you think Cutting Crew would fare if starting out now in this digital age?
Thank you, Jane. Well, musical style aside, you know, I think if we released an album now with Die in Your Arms on it, who knows, it might not even get noticed. That's an even better question, isn't it? Would your hit record be noticed if it was released now? Anyway, digital age, I'm shite at it. I've got a person that does it for me. Our Facebook has gone up like, you know, 10 times since I've employed him. It's crucial. I think by digital age, I think she means also about the fact that we stream instead of buy. Mm-hmm. And I've got quite strong opinions on that. And that is that you'll remember when you bought, let's make up, Dark Side of the Moon, or, you know, Rubber Soul by the Beatles, Genesis albums. One of the pleasures of being an artist, and one of the skills, is putting an album together, you know, the first track. Putting it all together. So it's a long piece of enjoyment that we used to put records on and do. Now we cherry pick, as you know, with streaming. So I think that's something that maybe a band like Cutting Crew that put together albums that have themes and things through, I think we wouldn't have fared as well today, because that's one of the things that our fans loved. You know, they go, what's that little bit of noise between track 6 and track 7? You know, and it would be Kevin mucking around on something. So if that's a good answer.
Okay. Well, it is. It's a different world. And the beauty of having an album and getting an album, you know, especially vinyl, you know, all of that beauty is lost. Vinyl is making a comeback to a point that, you know, as you say, streaming has sadly given people the opportunity just to pick and choose the tracks they've heard on the radio. So much incredible material must get lost.
I know. And just to end, there's two sides to that as well, isn't there? One is that that bad side. And the other side is that anybody can get their records heard. So it gives much more opportunity for being noticed. But you have to wade through tons of stuff.
What was the kind of standout rock and roll moment of your career that you could think of?
Probably the Grammys. We flew in and we were nominated for Best Band, Best New Band. of course, that, you know, will last forever. We didn't win, but that's fine. I remember going to all the parties afterwards. We went to Elton John's party, and, you know, that which everybody was like, who are they? But that's fine. And then I remember going to Prince's party, and this, I'm sorry if there's Prince fans, you might think this is rude. I don't mean it rudely. But it was in, you know, a crowded club in downtown Manhattan. And all we could see was like four big guys walking around the room who were obviously his bodyguards, but never saw him because he's so little. we just saw these four guys walking. So we went to Prince's party, but we never saw him.
That's a great story. It's been an absolute delight to talk to you. We can't wait to see you in July at Forever Young. Thank you for joining us in Ireland in the summer. And best of luck with the knee. Love from everybody in Ireland. Ladies and gentlemen, Nick Van Eed.
Thank you very much indeed. Pleasure.
Thank you.